Okay, good morning students. Is my voice clear for you? Am I audible to you all? You kindly respond to me so that we can continue with the concepts. Okay, so in our last class we have completed the recursion concept. Okay, we have seen how the recursion is helpful in order to achieve the repetition process in our programming. Okay, we have seen some of the examples using this recursion, how we can solve the finding the factorial of a given number and finding the Fibonacci sequence up to the given number. So these two things we have done in our last class. Yeah, quickly we will see today's concepts. That is, we said structures. This entire thing we discussed in our last class. So recursion, the example, the definition, examples, finding the factorial using iterative approach. We discussed this formulae, and the example also we have seen. And this is a recursive approach for finding the factorial. And this is the problem for iterative solution, and this is the problem for recursive solution. Okay, so then. Fibonacci numbers, what is Fibonacci series? Okay, we said this series was named after the famous Italian mathematician Leonardo Fibonacci of 13th century. Okay, so people are asking me to explain the factorial of factorial of a given number, how to find the factorial of a given number, that program explanation they are asking. So quickly we'll do that first before moving any further. Just give me a second, I need to open that Dave CPP so that to show the So we will see both the examples, how we can find the factorial of a given number using iterative approach and how we can do the same using recursive approach. This is the program for finding the factorial using iterative approach. Okay, iterative solution to find the factorial of a given problem. And in the next slide, I kept the recursive solution. So this is your recursive solution to find the factorial of a given number. Okay, both the things we have to see. So recursive solution as well as the iterative solution. We have to see these two things. So one by one we will do. First, we will go with recursive solution. Iterative solution. Using iterative solution, how we can find the factorial of a given number. That we will see first. Okay. So this is your Dave CPP. So quickly I am taking. An empty file. And here I am writing my program. So quickly over here, in order to find the factorial, so what I have done, I have to take, as it is a recursive solution, iterative solution, finding the factorial of a given number with the help of a function. So that function name, I'm taking it as factorial. So my function, factorial function, will take an integer parameter. So factorial is my function name. Okay, and it will take an integer parameter and it will also return an integer parameter. So the return type must be int. So over here, what I'm doing, I'm taking two variables. Just give me a second. I'm taking two variables, n comma result. Okay, just to hold the result, I'm taking the result and this n to run my loop. Okay, to read the number, whatever number for which you want to calculate the factorial, that number I'm going to read inside this n. Okay, so quickly read that number, printf, enter any number. So here you have to enter the number for which you want to calculate the factorial. So immediately what we have to do, we have to read that number inside this n, isn't it? So how can we read? Using scanf. Scanf of percentile d comma and percent n. Now my number is inside this n. So I have to calculate the factorial of this n. So using this function only I can calculate. So immediately this function will return integer value. So initialize this function call with this result. So what will be my next statement? Result equals to, I'm calling that function. Okay, factorial of, so this is my factorial function. Okay, factorial of, what I have to do? Here you put number n, pass that number n. This is a call by value mechanism. Okay, so after this function call, what will happen? I will get the factorial of this n inside this result variable. So print that result variable on the output screen. Use the printf. Okay, I got some antivirus alert. So I will close this one. Yeah, come back over here. So factorial of. Factorial of percentile d is put percentile d. Okay, so this first percentile d will be my n because I'm calculating the factorial of n only. So whatever value I'm going to have inside this n, that same value I will get at this percentile d. So my second percentile d will be my result because this will be the result of the factorial. After calculating the factorial of n, the result will be inside this res variable. So that res variable I have to print over here. So the first variable percentile d, put that n because I'm calculating the factorial of n. And my second variable, my second variable, the result variable I have to print here. Clear? I have to print here my result variable. I have to print here. So quickly do that res. Okay, so like this you will get the factorial of a given number. So now this percentile, I mean this factorial, okay, this factorial, it is a user defined function, isn't it? It is not a predefined function. I took this name as factorial, so it is a user defined function. Nowhere the definition of this function is available inside the library files. So what I have to do, I have to provide the definition for this factorial function. So that definition, how can we provide that definition? After the main, we have to provide. So int factorial of int, and here you have to pass the variable as well, a formal variable. This is your actual parameter, and here you have to pass a formal parameter. That formal parameter, I am taking it as num. So whatever value you are passing with the help of this n over here, that same value will be copied inside this num. N to num value will be copied. This n is your actual parameter, and this num is your formal parameter. In that way, you have to remember. Clear? So the next thing, I have to provide the coding for that factorial function. So I'm taking a temporary variable over here to run the loop, and then to calculate the factorial internal to this block, internal to this function, I'm taking fact variable, fact equals to 1. So now you quickly try to, we will do the analysis first. Okay, first we will do the analysis, then we will see the output. So run the for loop for all, okay, for all I equals to 1, I must be less than or equals to num. I have to run this loop up to this num. Okay, because I want to calculate the factorial of this num only. So then I plus plus. So internal to this one, internal to this loop, I have to put only one statement. That is, every time I have to do factorial equals to factorial multiplied with I. It is an important program, finding the factorial of a given number. This is iterative approach. After this, we do the recursive approach as well. Okay, then after finding the factorial, before you return, before you exit from this function, you have to return that factorial value, because inside this fact only, we are going to store the factorial in this block, in this function block. So as this function will return this factorial, this factorial value, this fact value will be stored inside this result. From here to here, the value will be passed. And the same value you are printing using this printf function over here. So quickly we'll do a simple analysis over here of this program. So I will open the slide. So the same program I have written over there. So we'll do the analysis on this program, and then we will see the output, how the output will come for that program. Okay. So let us assume, so first the program execution will start from this point. From here, the program execution will start. Okay, before starting this program execution, the compiler will come to know that you are going to use a function, a user-defined function with name factorial, which will take only one input value and which will return only one output value. Both the types over here, input type as well as output type, is of type integer only. So the program execution will begin here at this point. Then two variables will be initialized to this block. Okay, to this block here, to this block, two variables will be initialized. What are my variables? The first variable is n, and the second variable is result. Sorry, we have to say defined because we have not done the initialization yet. Okay, two variables will be defined. Then what will happen using this printf statement? So the same statement you will get on the output screen. So as you can see, the output also I'm showing over here. On the output screen, when the program control executes this printf statement, this message you will get on the output screen. Okay, this message you will get on the output screen. Enter any number. Up to this only you will get on the output screen. Then this five value I'm entering with the help of keyboard. This 5 I'm entering from where? From the keyboard I'm entering, because I want to find out the value, I mean factorial value of that 5 with the help of this program. So this 5 we are entering from the keyboard. So next what will happen when you enter this 5 and hit the enter key? Okay, when you enter this 5 and hit the enter key, what will happen? This 5 will be stored, because here after this printf, we have the immediate statement, the scanf, isn't it? So we have the scanf. So what will happen? This 5 will be stored inside this n. So your n will become 5 now. Your n will become 5 now. To this block, n will become 5 now. Next, what we are doing? We are invoking, we are calling this factorial function. Okay, we are calling this factorial function by passing this n. And why I have done the initialization? Why I have done the initialization of this function call to this result means, because my factorial will return an integer type of value. Already we told the compiler that we are going to return an integer value from this factorial function. So that integer value will be assigned to this result variable. Okay, so then we are passing 5 over here. So n will be 5 and that same 5 will be passed in this factorial function as an argument, as a parameter. Okay, so as an actual parameter. So that n will be copied, because immediately whenever you are invoking this function, the compiler will look for the suitable definition for this function. Where that suitable definition is, here we have specified that suitable definition. After the main function, we have specified this definition of factorial function. Because it is a user-defined function, it is our responsibility to give the definition of this factorial function that we have given over here. This entire thing, we call it as function definition. This is your function call. This is your function call. This is your function definition. And this is your function declaration. Okay. So immediately what will happen when you pass this n over here, the value 5 will be copied from this n to this num. Okay. So now to this block, how many variables we have? Inside this block, we have num. Okay. All those variables I'm writing over here. We have num, we have I, okay, we have I, then we have this fact also, okay, that fact also I'm taking. We have num, we have I, and we have factorial fact. And so far we have initialized only num by passing this n value over here. We passed this n value over here so that n 5 will take, 5 will be passed as an actual parameter at the place of this n. The same 5 will be copied inside this num. Okay, from n to num, only 5 will be copied. So your num will become 5 now. Your num will become 5 now. So after this, what we have? Yeah, come to this loop. Because after this declaration, after this definition of, and fact, as you can see over here, we have initialized the fact value 1. So that same 1 you put over here. That same 1 you put over here. Okay, clear? Then inside this loop, we have only this statement. Don't think that this for loop will continue for these two statements. As you can see, there is a difference. In keeping these two statements, I followed a difference over here. So when I make this space over here, it indicates that this for loop is applicable only to this statement. Okay, as there is no compound statement. If you have multiple statements to put over here, what we have to do? We have to use the curly brackets. As I'm not using any curly brackets, that means the for loop will follow only this one statement. Okay, only this one particular statement is the part of your for loop. Okay, only this one particular statement is the part of your for loop. So now, yeah, inside this for loop, as you can see, what we are doing, we are initializing I with 1. Okay, we are initializing I with 1. So that 1 will come over here. I will be initialized to 1. Now the condition will be tested. 1 is less than or equals to num. Num is 5. 1 is less than or equals to 5. So the condition is true. So immediately what will happen? It will execute this statement. Fact equals to fact multiplied with I. What is fact value? 1. 1 multiplied with 1, it will remain 1 only. Isn't it? 1 multiplied with 1, 1 only. So that 1 we are initializing to fact. So fact, there will be no change. It will remain as it is. 1 only. So then the next iteration, because it is a loop, it will go to the next iteration. Okay, because it is a loop, it will continue until and unless this condition will become false. So now in the previous iteration, the condition was true and it has executed the body of the loop. So it will return to this updation. Now I value gets incremented. I value will become I plus one, that is I value is 1. So 1 plus 1, that will become 2 now. I value is 2 now. Clear? I value is 2 now. So then what will happen? Fact equals to fact multiplied with IVRC. It is the body of the loop. So what is fact value? 1. 1 multiplied with 2. That is 2. Isn't it? 1 multiplied with 2. That is 2. Then fact will become 2 now. Fact is 2 now. I think I have explained this problem yesterday, this program yesterday. No, because we are not using any mathematical related functions in this program. No predefined function related to mathematics we are using. Isn't it? Math.h, that is the reason why we are not including. If you are using any of math.h library functions, on that day I have explained. Standard library functions, on that day I have explained what are the functions of math.h. So if you are using any of those functions like absolute, okay, ceiling, floor, trunk, round, square root, power, if you are using any of these functions, then only you have to include that math.h into your program. Okay, because this factorial, as I said, it is not a predefined function. Factorial is not a predefined function. It is a user defined function. I myself defining that function over here. You can see the coding over here. This entire thing is suitable for factorial. Okay. So that is the reason why I'm not including math.h in my program, because I'm not using any standard library function in this program. I'm using only this printf, scanf, and these printf, scanf, these two library functions are part of your stdio.h that you already know. So that is the reason why I'm including only stdio.h and no other function I'm using which belongs to your math.h. So that is the reason why I'm not including math.h in my program. If you are using any of that function, any of the math.h library function, then you must have to include that math.h library file into your program. Clear? So now we'll come over here and we will see. So immediately fact equals to 2 now, then the control will go to the I and I will get updated. So I will become 3 now, because I plus plus in the sense I equals to I plus 1. So I will become 3 now. Then fact equals to fact multiplied with I. What is fact value? 2. 2 multiplied with I. That is nothing but 3. 2 multiplied with 3. So now fact will become 6. After 2, fact will become 6. Next iteration, I value gets updated. I value becomes 4 now. So 4 less than or equals to 5. Condition true. Then fact equals to fact multiplied with I. So that is nothing but fact equals to, what is fact value? 6 multiplied with I, 4. 6 fours, 24. So fact will become 24 now. Fact is 24 now. Next iteration, again, I value gets updated. I value becomes 5 now. I value is 5 now. Still the condition is true, because 5 is less than or equals to 5. I value is 5 and num value is also 5. Here we have equals to sign. That means the condition is true. So next, what will happen? Again, fact equals to fact multiplied with I. What is fact value? Fact value is 24. And what is I value? I value is 5 now. So what will happen? 25 multiplied with 5. 24 multiplied with 5. So that is nothing but 120. So now the fact value became 120. So in the next iteration, I value gets updated. I value will become 6 now. Okay, I value is 6 now. So then 6 is less than or equals to 5, because num value is 5. 6 is less than or equals to 5. Condition false. When this condition becomes false, what will happen? The control will not go to this fact. Okay, fact equals to fact multiplied with I. The control will directly go to this return fact. Okay, fact, return fact, what it will do, whatever fact is holding. Whatever fact is holding. Inside fact, what we have? We have this 120. Inside fact, we have this 120. So that 120 will be copied from here to this result, because that 120 will be returned by this function. So that 120 will come over here at this place. So the same 120 will be put inside this result. Okay, so now result will become 120. Now result will become 120. So after this statement, we have this printf statement. Printf factorial of percentile d. This percentile d is nothing but your n value. So if you see inside this block, we have not changed the n value. N value will remain as it is, 5. So here you will get 5. Factorial of 5 is percentile d. That is nothing but here result get replaced. Result get RES get replaced. So RES value is 120. So that 120 you will get over here. So in that way you are getting the output. In that way you are getting this output. Enter any number 5. When you are entering 5, this 5 goes to n, from there to num, and this entire thing will happen, and this result, this factorial fact value will be returned, and that same value will be stored inside this RES, and that value we are printing on the output screen. Yeah, I'm not audible to you all. Is my voice clear to you all? Because somebody raised that question. You people able to hear me properly or not? You people are able to hear me properly or not? Just response, give the response. Is the streaming is live? Yeah, I hope so. Who is this Jahangiruddin? He's raising question, then why is disturbing the class? I mean, roll number 26. Am I audible? Yes, people are saying I'm audible. If there is any problem with you, just check your mobile. Okay. So quickly we'll go to the, yeah, my streaming is also live. I've checked. So, and I'm getting the positive responses. So I will continue with the concept. So in this way, it will print the factorial of a given number. So that same thing, we'll do the practice. Yeah, quickly I have written this program over here. So I just have to save this program. Save this program with today's date. Test of, what is today's date? It is 3rd of April, I think is 3-4.c/, it will not accept. So 3-4.c. So I'm saving the program. Your program is saved. Just go to compile. So as you can see, hopefully there are no errors. Yeah, no errors. So quickly go and execute, run the program. So it is asking me, to enter any number. Okay. So as I told you, it is asking me enter any number. So if I enter 5, then it will give the factorial as 120. That output I have explained. So next thing, I'm just entering and run because I want to take some other number. If I want to calculate the factorial of 7, okay. If I want to calculate the factorial of 7. So then hit enter to see the output. So it will be 5040, okay. So in that way, you can check the, I mean, you can calculate the factorial of a given number. So this is the iterative solution. Whatever we have done, it is an iterative solution. So we have to see the recursive solution also. Recursive in the sense where a function is going to call itself. That solution also we have to see. I will explain that program also. First, I will write that program. Then we will do the follow-up. Okay. By opening the slide, I will show you how that execution takes place. So quickly what I have to do, yeah, that simple formulae I will use when I'm going to calculate the factorial of a given number using recursive approach, I use this formulae. See, whenever n value is 0, I have to use factorial as 1. And whenever n value is other than 0, what I have to do? I have to use this formulae. N multiplied with factorial of n minus 1. This formulae I have to use. So quickly, I will start writing that program in this same window. Just delete this one and start writing the program. So hash, instead doing that, So instead of doing that, this entire thing I will remove, because only these things are going to change. Okay, rest of the things are same. So here also I'm going to use a function int factorial equals to int, and then I'm going to read the value using n, and I'm going to pass that value, and after finding the factorial I'm going to print the result in the same way. So till this point your program will remain same, and where the program will change means inside that function definition, because inside the function definition only previously we used iterative approach, and now we are going to use the recursive approach. Understood? Now we are going to use the recursive approach. Just see the recursive approach, how we are calculating. So what I said, whenever my number is equals to zero, because whatever I'm going to read inside this n, the same n I'm going to get a copy inside this num, isn't it? This n to num I'm going to get a copy. So if my num value is zero, so what is the factorial? So I have to return one. My factorial will be one, isn't it? If it is anything other than that zero, then what I have to do? I have to make return of, so that value, num multiplied with factorial of, I have to call the function recursively, num minus one, isn't it? N multiplied with factorial of n minus 1. So in place of n, I kept num. Understood? So num multiplied with factorial of num minus 1. So in this way, we can calculate the factorial. Only this much you have to write. Inside this function definition, only this much you have to write. No loop, nothing. Okay? So quickly we'll go and we will see the slide where the function definition only changes. Isn't it? Where only the function definition changes. This is your factorial of a given number using recursive approach, recursive solution to find factorial problem, So here we will see, so here we have two variables, n and result, isn't it? N and result, like in my previous case, here I have two variables, n and result. Here how many variables? Only one variable, as you can see, only num, no I, nothing, no fact, nothing we are using, only one variable we are using, that is num. And every time I have to know how this num value will changes, okay? So this num variable I'm taking over here, then here n and result, two variables I have. So initially, as usual, the program execution will begin from here, and it will ask you to enter any number, and let us say you are entering 5. From the keyboard, you are entering this 5. So this 5 will be stored inside this n, because you are reading that number over here. Using scanf, you are reading that number. This percentile d will be stored inside this n. So at this percentile d, you will get this 5. So that will be saved inside this n. So now n will become 5. Next is, we are calling this factorial of n. So that 5 will be passed over here. So this 5 will be copied. This n will be copied from here to this num. So now num will become 5. Num is 5. Understood? So the next thing, the control will jump from here to here, because we have this function call. So now the function, now the program will come, program counter will come over here to execute this function definition. Okay. So inside this function definition, first we are checking whether num value is 0 or not. Is it? No, it is not. Num value is 0. Yes, they will ask in external. Factorial, recursive, iterative, Fibonacci, recursive, iterative, GCD, recursive, iterative. three problems. For each problem, we have two solutions. One using iterations, one using recursion. So total three problems. Six programs. Okay, two for factorial in a recursive way, in an iterative way. Two for Fibonacci, recursive way, iterative way. Two for GCD, recursive way, iterative way. In that way, you have to remember, you have to practice these six programs. Understood? These six programs are very important, and they will ask definitely, because under that recursion, there is nothing to ask apart from these examples. Okay, apart from these examples, there is nothing to ask inside your recursion. So you have to know what is recursion, the definition of recursion, the advantage of recursion, and then these three problems, factorial, Fibonacci, and GCD. These three problems you have to understand along with the problem solutions. Okay, problem solution in iterative way, problem solution in recursive way. So as you can see, when I explained this factorial, I have given two solutions. So this is your factorial problem. So problem in the sense, you have to remember this entire thing, this entire slide, iterative definition for factorial problem. So what is factorial? Then what is the iterative solution and the example? Then recursive definition for factorial problem. Again, what is recursive definition? I have given over here. This slide also you have to remember. Then this is just the recursive solution explanation. This also you have to remember. Then this one, the program for finding the factorial in a iterative approach. Then program to find the factorial in a recursive approach. This thing we are practicing now. Okay, so quickly come over here. So n 5, that 5 will be copied inside this num. So here we are checking num value whether it is 0 or not. As it is not 0, so the control will jump to the else part. So over here what we are seeing, we are calculating num multiplied with factorial of num minus 1. So that 5 will come over here. 5 multiplied with, so factorial of num minus 1. So factorial of num minus 1 in the sense, what will happen here? Num minus 1. So factorial of 4 will be invoked. Factorial of 4 will be invoked. So if factorial of 4 you are invoking, then num value will become what? 4, because here you are passing 4. 5 minus 1, 4 you are passing. So that same 4 will come over here inside this num. So now num will become 4. Okay. So if num is 4, then if num equals to 0, it will be checked. As it is not 0, num not equals to 0, then what will happen? Again else part. Again inside else part, what will happen? Again you have num multiplied with factorial of num minus 1. So what is num? 4. So 4 multiplied with, again, factorial of num minus 1, factorial of 4 minus 1. So now num will become 3. So again, 3 multiplied with factorial of num minus 1, factorial of 2. So num will become 2. So next, again, 2 multiplied with factorial of num minus 1, num minus 1, 2 minus 1, factorial of 1. Again, the control will come over here. 1 multiplied with factorial of num minus 1. Factorial of num minus 1 in the sense, factorial of, yeah, here it will become 1. So factorial of num minus 1 this time. This time factorial of num minus 1 in the sense, 1 minus 1. So now num will become 0. So when num 0, what will happen? If num equals to 0, return 1. That 1 will come over here. Finally, that num will come over here. So what will happen? This entire thing you calculate, it will be equivalent to 120 only. It will be equivalent to 120 only. So in that way, this 120 will be returned from this factorial function. So that 120, where it will be copied? Inside this result. Inside this result, that 120 will be copied. Okay, so over here it will come. So now result will become 120. Okay, so in this way, when you print the factorial of percentile D, the one value will get replaced with this percentile D and the result value gets replaced with this percentile D. So n is holding 5. So 5 you will get over here. And this result is holding 120. So that 120 will come over here. So in this way, you will get this complete statement on the output screen. Quickly, we'll go there and we will see. So this is your program. Just now I have written and I have saved. Now go compile. Compilation successful. Go execute. So if you see the output screen, it is asking me to enter any number. So here I'm entering, first we will see the same by giving the same input 5. So I have to get 120, I'm getting 120. So in that way, you can calculate the factorial of a given number. So the next thing, enter, go here, execute, run and enter any other number. So this time I'm entering like 7, hit enter, so 5040 you are getting. So in this way, you can calculate the factorial of a given number using a recursive approach. So quickly, after this explanation, we will go to that structures. So just I will give the brief idea because we are running out of time now. So I will give the brief idea about what is a structure, the programming concepts, and more examples we will see in tomorrow's class. Okay. So when it comes to structure, so what we said, what is an array? How we defined the array? Array is nothing but we said array is a collection of homogeneous data elements. Isn't it? Array is a collection, first of all. Array is a collection. And second, we said what type of collection? It is a collection of data elements of homogeneous data types. Isn't it? Homogeneous types. So here, when we talk about a structure, it is a collection. It is also a collection. Structure is also a collection only. So a structure is a collection of heterogeneous data elements. Heterogeneous in the sense different, where homogeneous means same, heterogeneous in the sense different. So if you read the second statement in this slide, you will understand it clearly. A structure is a collection of, here you can see, a structure is a collection of items of different data types. Okay, so different data type elements we can put inside a structure. We can collect data items belonging to different data types into this structure. Okay, a structure is a collection of heterogeneous data elements. Simply this definition you remember. An array, what is the difference between array and a structure? Array is a collection of homogeneous data elements, same data elements, but whereas a structure, it is a collection of heterogeneous data elements, different data elements. Only that difference. That means if you are declaring an array of type integer, your complete array will hold only integers. Isn't it? Your complete array will hold only integers. Declaring an array of integers, can we put the characters into it? No, it is not put, not possible. Can we put the float values into it? No, it is not possible. Clear? But if you declare a structure, inside a structure, you can put data elements of different types. Okay? Data elements of different types. So as you can see, over here, I'm declaring a simple structure with name student. Okay? With name student, I'm declaring a simple structure where name is going to be the string, isn't it? It is a string. String is nothing but your character array, isn't it? We already know string is nothing but it is a character array delimited with a delimiter. Okay. So next, ID, we can put it as integer. Okay, ID, it can be an integer, and marks, here you can take integer array. So integer array. So that means we can put an array also inside a structure. So name, it is a character array. Then ID, integer, then marks, it is also an integer array. So in this way, we can collect elements of different data types, integer, character, and if you want to take this marks as float or double, that you can take. So as you are taking more than one marks, you are saying, isn't it? Marks you are saying, so you have to take an array, float array like that. So character, integer, float, three different types of data elements I kept inside this structure. This structure. So this structure, it is a collection of heterogeneous data elements. In that way, you have to remember. Structure is a collection of data elements of different types. Data elements of different types. Okay. So quickly. So as you can see over here, when I declared that structure, here I have given the elaboration. So for that simple structure, you can create different variables like student 1, student 2, student 3, where every variable, every structure variable is going to hold all these records, all these details. So student, we have a type, isn't it? There I have declared this student, as you can see. This is the student declaration. So now using this student, I can create more than one variable. Student, student 1, student 2, student 3, like that I can declare. So now inside this student one, how many variables, how many different variables I have? I have a variable name of type string. I have a variable ID of type integer. I have a variable marks of type float. So in that way, in every student variable, you can put these stuff, these content. So here student one will hold the name. Okay. And then the ID and then the marks, where name is of type string and ID is of type integer and marks are of type float. So in that same way here, student 2, it is holding a name of type string, integer, float. Understood? So in this way you can store elements belonging to different data types inside a structure. So each variable inside a structure, we call it as a field, as you can see over here, this thing, this important thing you have to remember. So each element in a structure is called a field. A field is the smallest element of named data that has meaning. Okay, so it is a field where we are going to hold the, where we are going to store the actual data inside a structure. So where we are storing the actual data inside a structure, in the sense, inside a field only. Okay, so it has many characteristics of a variable. So this struct, I mean this field, it is the same like your variable, but it is also having some differences. So we have to say there is a similarity between variable and a field. Okay, so like a variable, your field will also be, your field can also be initialized. Okay, initialization we have to do for both the things. Variables we are initializing, fields also we have to initialize, and later it can be manipulated. So like variable, you can change the value of a variable. Same like you can change the value of a field as well. Okay, and the only difference, okay, where they differ, where the variable and a field will differ, in the sense, okay, structure fields are the parts of the structure. Variable, you can use them independently, but whereas fields, you can't use them independently because they are parts of a structure. So in order to use the fields, we have to qualify them with the structure name. Okay, all those things we will see with the help of a program. So fields are the part of your structure. Variables, they are independent things. In order to manipulate the variables, we no need to depend on anything. We can manipulate them, we can change them without depending on anything. But whereas in order to manipulate the content of this field, in order to manipulate these fields, we have to qualify them. We have to qualify the fields by using the structure name. We have to qualify the fields by using the structure variable name. Okay, so in that way you remember, yeah, here you can see the difference between an array and a structure. Array will hold all elements of same data types, but whereas structure will hold variables of type different. Okay, so here you can see all elements in an array must be of same type. Okay, but all elements in a structure can be of same or different type. It is not mandatory that you have to maintain of same or different type. You can put same or different, isn't it? We can even put the same types. So if you have a structure like this over here, can't I put all types as integers? Yes, I can. That is also possible. But using an array when you have all data types of same type is the easiest solution. So when we have to go for structures, only when you have to put different data type elements. If you want to put same data type elements, then why we have to go for structures? We can easily do that with the help of arrays itself. So that kind of flexibility is also there. That is the reason why we are saying all elements in a structure can be of same type or different type. Okay, so a structure is a convenient way in which data are grouped into a single name. It is a convenient way. Okay, so structure type definition, how we are going to define a structure, in the sense, like every, yeah, because you know, whatever objects we are going to use in your programming, we must have to declare, define and initialize, isn't it? So like every other objects in C, a structure must be declared and defined, and also I forgot to put the initialization stuff over here. It has to be initialized as well before it used. Okay, before you can use a structure, you must have to do these three things. You have to declare the structure, you have to define the structure, and you have to initialize the structure. Understood? Like every other object in C, every other element in C, a structure must be declared, defined, and initialized. So what are the ways how we can declare, how we can define, and how we can initialize, that we discuss in the in our next concepts. Okay, so in C we have two ways to declare a structure. How many ways we have to declare a structure? We have two ways, that is tagged structures and type defined structures. The first approach is tagged structures and the second approach is type defined structures. You can follow any of these two approaches, any one of these two approaches. Okay, so quickly go to the next slide and see. So tagged structure, how you have to do the syntax, you see the tagged structure we use. First you have to give the tag. Okay, tag in the sense the name to the structure. You have to use the keyword struct, then followed by the name of that structure, and in between these parentheses, open parentheses, open curly bracket, close curly bracket, and then the semicolon. Like this only you have to do. This is the syntax. This is a general syntax to declare a tagged structure. So struct keyword followed by the tag, and inside these curly brackets you have to put all the fields. Okay, you have to put all the fields. So here you can see the example struct student, the same student I'm taking over here. So the first character array ID, then we are declaring marks. You can take any type over here because it is a random stuff I have taken. Previously I have explained with the help of integer character, like that, but here I am taking some different things. So it is completely generalized thing. So you can take anything over here. It is a randomized thing. You can take anything, whatever elements you want to put as members to that structure, as fields to that structure, you can keep over here. Clear? So a tagged structure, you have to use the keyword tag followed by the tag name, and all the fields you have to put between these curly brackets. All the fields you have to put between these curly brackets. And at the end, we are going to have this semicolon. Okay. So you have to remember, end of the structure declaration, we are going to have this semicolon. It is very important. So how we are declaring? The simple scenario, simple thing. We are using the keyword. It is this struct is a keyword. So you have to use as it is. Struct is the keyword. You can see over here I have written keyword struct. Struct followed by the tag. This student, name of the structure is nothing but the tag. And all the parameters you must put between these curly brackets. Okay, this is the declaration of a tagged structure. Okay, the next thing we have, type defined structure. So here we use the two keywords we use. Okay, we use two keywords. One is type def and the other one is struct. Okay, we use two keywords, and where we are specifying the type means at the end. The name we are specifying at the end. So this is type defined structure. So what we use? First we use type def keyword. Type def, struct, then the name, and between the curly brackets we specify all the fields, all the data members, whatever you want to put inside that structure, those data values you have to put, those data members, those fields you have to put between these curly brackets. Clear? So over here you see the example, I'm declaring that student structure using this type defined way. Okay, so I use the keyword type def followed by the keyword struct, then the name student, and in between I kept all the fields. So only simple difference here, only one keyword we are using, and the type will come over here. If you see type defined, what we are doing, we are using type def followed by type def followed by the keyword struct followed by keyword struct we are using followed by the curly brackets. Between these we are using the fields, isn't it? Fields. Okay, then here we are specifying the type name. Here we are specifying the type name. So after type name again we are putting the semicolon. So that is the only difference. So here the type name tag will come first with only one keyword struct, but over here we get an extra keyword type def, and that struct will come this side and the name will go down. Type name will go down. Only that difference between tagged structures and type defined structures. There is no difference between these two declarations. Whatever declaration you do with the help of type defined or with the help of tagged structures, you will get the same thing. You will get the same structure. But this second approach only we are going to use most probably. This type defined structure only, structures only we use in all your programs. Okay. Whenever it is possible, we use the tagged structures also. Simply you have to know both the things. If there are multiple ways of reaching a particular solution, you have to know all the ways, isn't it? That's why we are giving the explanation for both. How we can do the type defined structures and how we can do the tagged structures. In both the ways we are explaining. Okay, so type defined structures differ from tagged structures in these two ways. The difference I have already explained. Only in terms of names, only in terms of usage of keywords, they will differ. Okay, the keyword type def is added inside the type defined structures. Okay, and the second thing, the identifier is required at the end of the block. In the tagged structures, we are giving the identifier at the beginning. But in type defined structures, we are giving the identifier at the end. Okay, yes, I know the time is over. So the rest of the concepts we will discuss in our next class. Clear? Yeah, if you have any doubts in this concepts, you can post in the comment section. And in tomorrow's class, we will complete, inshallah, we will complete this entire structures as well as your unions. Okay, then we will be left with only that files concept. It is very simple concept, files concept. Hardly it will take like half an hour to explain. Okay, that files concept, we have to discuss only the introduction. Okay, we don't have to go into deep. We just have to discuss the introduction from that files. Okay, inshallah, I will complete that one in my next class. And with that, we can conclude all five units. Okay, afterwards, if time permits, we will do the practice of previous year university question papers. We will try to solve the previous year university question papers. And we will do the lab programs. Okay, whenever it is possible, I will post the videos in your group. Okay, I will create the videos and I will post the videos in your group. You just follow those videos. Clear? Okay, thank you very much.